Now that we've read the passage, let's see if we can answer the questions. In the context of the passage, the author's use of the phrase, her light step flying to keep time with his long stride, lines 4 to 5, is primarily meant to convey the idea that, so that's right over here, lines 4 to 5. So her light step flying to keep time with his long stride. So remember, this is, you know, Maddie and Silver had lived under Ethan's roof for a year, and from early morning till they met at supper, he had frequent chances of seeing her, but no moments in her company were comparable to those when, so he's talking about a really good time, when her arm in his and her light step flying to keep time with his long stride, they walked back through the night to the farm. So you kind of imagine, you know, he's this, you know, this guy, and he's these long strides, and you know, he's not normal, he's not used to being kind of connected to people and being happy around people, but then there's her and her light step flying to keep time with his. So you imagine this person, and they're kind of having these enthusiastic, spirited conversations. I mean, we read the whole passage about nature and about science and about feeling this connection. So yeah, this first choice, Ethan and Maddie share a powerful enthusiasm. That looks like what's being described. I mean, in fact, as we read on, we realize that that's at least what Ethan at the time thought was going on. B, Maddie strives to match the speed at which Ethan works. Well, no, that would be the case if, like, they were saying that he has this long stride and she was having trouble, and the whole passage was about her having trouble doing all the work in the house that she wants him to do and all of that. But that's not what it's about. The whole passage is about this powerful enthusiasm, and it really starts from these early lines where we're talking about, you know, this is the time that he liked being around her and this connection, and her light steps flying to keep time with his long stride. You know, they're having fun, the spirited, passionate conversations in the night. Maddie and Ethan playfully compete with each other. Compete? Well, no, the spirit of competition doesn't really play out here. In fact, most of what he kind of talks about, he likes being like this teacher, professorial figure, this father figure kind of that likes to awaken her appreciation of the planet. So it doesn't really seem like a competitive or even a playfully competitive relationship. It's really he's the teacher, at least he thinks he's the teacher, and she's the student who's appreciating him and nature. Ethan walks at a pace that frustrates Maddie. Well, no, nothing in the passage makes us think that, or at least in the beginning, that Maddie somehow got frustrated by Ethan. It sounds like, you know, at least at those times, you know, when he's reminiscing about it, that he believes that she's really enjoying all of this. So I would definitely go with A. Let's go to the next question. The description in the first paragraph indicates that what Ethan values most about Maddie is her fitness for farm labor. No, in fact, he says right over here, she don't look much on housework, so it's not going to be that. Vivacious youth, that's possible. I mean, she is this kind of youthful spirit that's entered his life. Receptive nature, freedom from worry. So the receptive nature is interesting too, because he talks in the whole passage about how open she is about learning about the stars and about geology and whatever else. Well, let's see. But she don't look much on housework, but she ain't a fretter anyhow. But then they say, but it was not only that the coming to his house of a bit of hopeful young life was like the lighting of a fire on a cold breath. So he's saying it wasn't only essentially her vivacious youth. The girl was more than the bright, serviceable creature he had thought her. She had an eye to see and an ear to hear. He could show her things and tell her things and taste the bliss of feeling that all he imparted left long reverberations and echoes he could wake at will. So this is, you know, it starts off saying, look, it didn't look like she was, you know, necessarily, you know, the most impressive person to look at from a labor point of view. And sure, she had vivacious youth, but that wasn't it. The really powerful thing about her is she had an eye to see and an ear to hear. He could show her things and tell her things and taste the bliss of feeling that all he imparted left long reverberations and echoes he could wake at will. So it really is about the receptive nature. She was open to these things that he wanted to teach her, and she was, at least he thought, excited about these things. Question 4, which choice provides the best evidence for the answer to the previous question? Well, actually, I think I highlighted them. She had the girl was more than the bright, serviceable creature he had thought her. She had an eye to see and an ear to hear. He could show her things and tell her things. So let's see, which of these are that? This is like line 15 through 16, 17, 18. That's actually, I happened to highlight those exact lines. I like to do these, as you can tell, in real time so that I'm experiencing it as you would experience it. But luckily, I literally, well, anyway, you get the point. This is the line that tells, these are the lines that say that she was receptive. She had an eye to see and an ear to hear. He could show her things and tell her things. So definitely go with that. The author includes the descriptions of the sunset, the clouds, and the hemlock shadows. Hemlock is a type of plant, so the shadows of the plants were nature. So lines 41, 43, so let's go down to lines 41, line 41, 43, and I'll start reading a little early. And there were other sensations, less definable, but more exquisite. More exquisite. So before he's talking about kind of science of the stars and you know, being able to think about what's in the fossil record and all of that. But then they're saying, and there were other sensations, less definable but more exquisite, which drew them together with a shock of silent joy. The cold red of sunset behind the winter hills, the flight of cloud flocks over slopes of golden stubble, or the intensely blue shadows of hemlock on sunlit snow. When she said to him once, it looked just as if it was painted. So this is just that kind of, that incredible, I mean, I feel it. Maybe I should have hung out with Ethan Frome. but when you're in nature, there's this indescribable feeling of how it just connects with you, the beauty of it all. So this is what they're describing over here when we're talking about the sunset, the clouds, the hemlock shadows. So it suggests the peacefulness of the natural world. Oh, yeah. No. Emphasize the acuteness of two character sensations. Yeah, I like that because he's talking about him, you know, in the passage we read it, that he was wondering, is he the only person who feels so strongly about nature and the beauty of the natural world? But he's at the time, he said, but I think I found someone in this Maddie who connects with this sensation, who understands it. Foreshadowing the decline of the fortunes of two characters? No, this isn't that. This is about their connection. Offer a sense of how fleeting time can be. No, this was about both of them. You know, him feeling this very basic passion for everything around him and this almost indescribable thing and her connecting with it. And, you know, when she says it looks just as if it was painted, he feels that she had just perfectly described what he was feeling, these sensations. So I definitely would go with B.